Imagine a world where electric vehicles recharge automatically without the hassle of cables. Imagine road trips without ever stopping to refuel or recharge. Some say that wireless EV charging is a game-changer technology that will spark a new era in transportation. Others say it's nothing more than a wasteful gimmick. In this video, we'll dig deeper into the issues at play so you can make up your own mind. We'll start our journey with the electrifying history of wireless charging, from its roots with Nikola Tesla and how it evolved to its current capabilities. We'll explore how the technology works, spotlight the innovators driving it forward, and consider where it might lead us. Along the way, we'll connect the dots on its potential impact on smart cities and also the roadblocks that might lie ahead. So if you're ready to plug into the future of electric vehicles, stay tuned. I'm Rosie Barnes. Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. The concept of wireless charging sounds incredibly futuristic, but it's actually over 100 years old. It dates back to the pioneering work of Nikola Tesla in the late 19th century, who experimented with transferring electricity through the air. But only in the early 2000s did the concept of wirelessly charging begin to gain traction. In New Zealand, Professor John Boyes and his team at the University of Auckland made advancements in inductive power transfer technology, which is an essential concept for wireless charging systems. However, it was in Genoa, Italy, where one of the first practical applications for vehicles emerged. In 2002, the city launched an ahead-of-its-time electric bus project that allowed buses to recharge their batteries wirelessly while waiting at bus stops. Isn't it about time that after over 100 years, wireless charging has finally become practical? First, for consumer electronics like smartphones, and now, possibly, it's ready to start disrupting the entire transportation sector. Today, wireless charging technology can be a tool to increase the convenience of charging electric vehicles and maybe even an enabler for future autonomous vehicle fleets that need almost no human intervention. It can also be an important element for smart cities, where people use technology and data to improve efficiency and quality of life by incorporating sensors and a lot of IoT, Internet of Things, devices. How would wireless charging be useful in smart cities then? First, we can embed wireless charging pads at bus stops, taxi stands, and along designated routes so public transport can remain continuously charged without the need for breaks in their schedule. This means that with a given number of buses, there can be more frequent and reliable services, which will attract more people to buses, which means lower transport emissions. Smart cities are always associated with clean and modern aesthetics, and wireless charging helps here too. By dropping the need for visible charging cables and bulky stations, wireless charging keeps streets tidy and aesthetically pleasing. In terms of safety, the absence of exposed cables and connectors reduces the risk of electrical accidents and tripping hazards. While smart cities and autonomous vehicle fleets seem like distant prospects, some believe wireless charging will become widespread sooner than you might think. However, we need to understand the technology better before making any judgments. Wireless charging uses electromagnetic fields to transmit energy from a transmitter to a receiver, allowing the battery to charge without any physical contact. Typically, wireless chargers operate on the principles of electromagnetic induction, where a coil of wires surrounding a magnet generates an electromagnetic field capable of inducing a current in another nearby coil. You've likely encountered wireless charging with smaller devices, such as smartphones and medical implants. The fundamental principles are the same as what is being used in electric vehicles. So, how does it work in vehicles? The wireless charging system consists of two key components, a ground pad installed on or embedded in the ground, and a vehicle pad attached to the underside of the vehicle. When the vehicle is positioned over the ground pad, an alternating current flows through the ground pad, creating a magnetic field. This field then induces a voltage across the vehicle pad, which is converted into direct current to charge the vehicle's battery. It's similar to cooking with an induction stove, where heat is generated directly in the pot without an open flame. Ground pad acts like the induction stove's cooking surface, and the vehicle pad on the car's underside is like the metal pot that receives this energy. There are already quite a few wireless charging options in use today. For personal cars, MIT spin-off Wytricity is licensing their magnetic resonance-based systems to automotive giants like Hyundai. They focus on high-efficiency systems capable of delivering up to 11 kilowatts of power for electric cars. Meanwhile, Plugless Power offers a wireless charging system that can be retrofitted to existing EVs like the Tesla Model S, Chevrolet Volt, and Nissan Leaf. Their system includes a charging pad installed on the garage floor and a vehicle adapter, ensuring that even older models can benefit from wireless innovation. In Australia, Lumen Freedom has developed both static and dynamic charging systems, certified and implemented in high-performance vehicles like McLaren's Speedtail Hyper GT. Wireless charging certainly sounds convenient, but there's potential for it to offer much more than just convenience. A lot of people are saying that wireless charging is going to be in every car park and home, enabling us to use our car batteries to power the electricity grid via vehicle-to-grid technology, and thereby revolutionize our whole power system. Let's put some numbers on that. In Australia, if all our 15.3 million passenger vehicles were electric and connected to the electricity grid during the 95% of the time that they are parked on average, the total energy storage could be 612 gigawatt hours, which is one whole day of all of Australia's average electricity consumption. And that includes industry and everything. So yes, I would say that is a potential revolution. I'm not sure that the success of vehicle-to-grid relies on wireless charging, though. While I think that wireless charging for private cars will be very popular for engaged tech nerds, the kind that line up overnight to be the first to get the new iPhone, I personally don't find it that inconvenient to plug in at home overnight. I still plug my phone in, even though I also have a wireless charger. And I might be wrong, but I think that most people will be like me and be just fine with a charging cable at their home. The one place I can see wireless charging really making a difference for personal cars is in big car parks, like shopping centers and workplaces, maybe apartment buildings, where it would be infeasible to have cables lying around all over the place to plug in charging in every bay. Perhaps there's a business case to be made by providing free charging and parking if you allow the car park owner to use your battery for grid backup. After all, there is real money to be made here. Recently in Australia, early V2G adopters made up to $300 in a single day by supplying electricity to the grid during a supply shortage. That was with wired charging though, so whilst I definitely agree that V2G is going to be revolutionary, I don't think it's the killer app that's going to make wireless charging go mainstream. I think a more likely space for wireless charging to shake things up is opportunity charging for things like taxis, buses, garbage trucks, security cars. These are the kind of vehicles that are driving around all day and stopping in the same places over and over for a while at a time. You can dramatically decrease the size of battery and amount of depot charging that you need in each of these cases if you add in little sips of power every time you stop, rather than needing to store a whole day's worth of energy and gulp it down in longer breaks back at the depot. Saving battery weight is better for roads. It means you can carry more passengers or garbage or whatever, not to mention the reduced embodied energy and environmental impacts from mining battery materials and manufacturing them. Some example projects doing opportunity charging include the Contra Costa County Transit Authority in California. Their battery electric buses travel over 200 miles daily with quick in-route charges enough to replenish all the energy used on the routes. In theory, if they never left the route, these buses would never need to be plugged in. This system has led to significant cost savings, reduced battery sizes, lower maintenance costs, and high reliability. Similarly, Induct EV has set up efficient wireless charging stations for bus fleets across the United States and a taxi fleet of electric Volvos in Gothenburg, Sweden. Link Transit's electric bus fleet in Washington charges wirelessly at various points throughout their routes, so they can cover distances up to 466 kilometers during their 17-hour shifts, even in harsh conditions like heavy snow and temperatures below minus 20 degrees. So that's opportunity charging, where the charging can be incorporated into stops they were already planning to make. But for vehicles that aren't frequently stopping, it's harder. Long-haul trucks travel long distances between stops, and the batteries needed to enable this are huge. To get enough charge in a short stop, an immense amount of power is needed. But there are wireless charging companies prepared to take on this immense challenge. A 500 kilowatt wireless charging system developed by Wave Charging can fully charge a large electric truck in under 15 minutes. For context, while an average home consumes about 30 kilowatt hours of electricity daily, this charger can provide that much energy in just 3.6 minutes without any cables. The idea that such high-power wireless charging systems could be installed at key locations like warehouses or the delivery bay of supermarkets is compelling. These are places that frequently dispatch or receive deliveries, and those delivery bays are in constant use, so the high-power charging infrastructure shouldn't be sitting idle often. But getting that huge amount of power from the grid to the warehouses and shops will be an immense electricity distribution challenge, probably requiring distribution grid upgrades and/or large stationary batteries added. Rather than taking the power to the charging, it will likely be easier to do the charging near the power. High power transmission lines pretty commonly run next to highways, so those would be good candidate locations. And this can be done while driving via dynamic wireless charging, where vehicles receive a continuous flow of energy through an air gap as they drive, ending the need for stops altogether. This would not only allow long-haul trucks to get away with much smaller batteries, it could also potentially eliminate the range anxiety associated with passenger EVs. Electrion has demonstrated dynamic wireless charging on public roads in the Smart Road Gotland pilot project. This system, located south of Stockholm, uses copper coils installed 8 centimeters beneath the road to provide wireless charging over a 1.6 kilometer segment, transferring up to 30 kilowatts per receiver. It has been tested with a 12-meter electric bus and a 40-ton retrofitted electric truck, performing efficiently even in snow and ice. The electric truck received a 100 kilowatt charge from the road while driving at speeds up to 80 kilometers per hour, the max permitted speed for trucks with trailers on roads in Sweden. But like we saw with V2G technology, while dynamic charging would be a game changer for long distance transport, wireless is not the only way to get the job done. There are contact charging alternatives like pantographs or breast systems from companies like Elon Road that may offer faster, cheaper, and more maintenance friendly solutions for dynamic charging. There are a lot of challenges that dynamic charging will need to overcome if it's to become the dominant technology. The infrastructure required to cover a meaningful amount of highways with charging is large, with coils needing to be embedded every 2 meters or so to ensure overlapping magnetic fields, which is needed to maintain power transfer when vehicles are traveling at highway speeds. Reliability will be key, as the coils need to be dug up if maintenance or repairs are needed. The US Department of Energy and Oak Ridge National Laboratory are working on some of these challenges. Progress so far from this research program includes the design of a 200 kilowatt wireless power transfer system and plans for broad implementation on key Atlanta roads. The team is also tackling issues like vehicle misalignment, electromagnetic field safety, and maintaining efficiency at high currents and voltages. Let's dig into some of those challenges now. First, efficiency. Wireless charging currently offers lower energy transfer efficiency than wired, which means longer charging times and more energy lost as heat. We're talking 75 to maybe 96% wireless efficiency compared to 95 plus for wired DC charging. There's a few causes for the low efficiency. Power transfer efficiency decreases significantly with distance due to electromagnetic interference, radiation losses, and resistance in the transmitting and receiving coils. This is particularly problematic for applications requiring high power over large distances, like electric vehicle charging. Also, alignment between the transmitting and receiving coils is critical. For instance, in inductive charging systems, a misalignment of just a few centimeters can lead to a decrease in efficiency by 10% or more. Further the misalignment, the greater the loss, with potential drops of up to 50% if the vehicle is not properly positioned over the charging pad. This sensitivity to alignment makes it crucial for wireless charging systems, especially dynamic ones, to have precise control mechanisms and possibly automated alignment features. A lot of progress has been made to improve the efficiency of wireless charging, including developing new coil designs and control algorithms. And progress has been made, with some reports of wireless charging as efficient or even perhaps more efficient than certain types of wired charging. But it's going to be really important to test efficiency in the real world with average users who might not be precision parkers and a full range of vehicle heights. The next big challenge is safety. There is an electromagnetic field surrounding wireless chargers. If I'm in the car while it's wirelessly charging, is that similar to being inside a microwave? That's actually not a baseless fear. Strong electromagnetic fields can negatively impact human health and interfere with other devices like defibrillators, pacemakers, and insulin pumps. But like the microwave in your kitchen, proper design can ensure that people or pets aren't exposed to the danger. Then we've got to consider that the risks increase if there's any damage. For example, if my car scrapes against a steep curb, could it pose a danger to my child if they go under the car and touch the charger? To prevent danger, strict regulations and guidelines are enforced to limit exposure and ensure safety for users and bystanders. That's where having reliable testing and measurement equipment becomes essential, ensuring that every component, from coils to control systems, works as efficiently and as safely as possible. This video is sponsored by Test Equity, a trusted partner in the electronics industry, providing the tools and supplies needed to test, assemble, and maintain the technology driving innovations like wireless EV charging. Another issue with wireless charging is standardization and interoperability. Anyone who has driven an EV knows how many different plugs and apps there are. These kinds of issues are probably going to be even more painful for wireless charging. For wired charging, you might spend a few minutes downloading an app, plug and unplug, start and restart charging until it finally works, drive to a different station if the one you're at isn't compatible, and you can always buy an adapter or a new cable if needed. For me, this is by far the most annoying part of owning an EV, and it needs to get sorted out before EVs can truly take over the mainstream. For wireless charging, standardization is going to be so much more crucial. You're not going to be able to just try a different highway if you can't connect to charge from the embedded coils in your planned route. And are we really going to have both a charging port for wired charging and a receiver for wireless charging on every car? Maybe multiple receivers even for multiple types of wireless charging? Or will it need to be one or the other in the long run to avoid redundancy and the cost and weight addition from doubling or tripling up? Then my final concern is related to the cost and disruption needed to install all this infrastructure. The cost of components can be significant, especially for high power and dynamic applications, not to mention extensive roadworks to install and maintain on-road systems. It's a big big upfront investment that will likely need to be made as a partnership between public and private enterprise. An example of this is a dynamic charging project in the city of Detroit, which has embedded inductive charging coils in a quarter mile segment of 14th Street. Maintenance and ownership responsibilities are shared between the charging technology company Electrion, alongside the Michigan Department of Transportation and the city of Detroit. And that's just for a small trial. Imagine now that we want to make a cohesive national or international scheme without compatibility issues. Now we've come to the end of our wireless charging journey. I started out probably more on the wireless charging is a gimmick side of the argument, but I have actually come around to the potential of this technology, especially for opportunity charging applications. And I have to admit, it is nice to imagine never needing to wrangle a heavy charging cable again, and every parked car being connected to the grid at all times, and dynamic charging, meaning that the distance between stops on your road trip will be dictated by the size of your bladder rather than the size of your fuel tank. Achieving this, though, will require significant infrastructure and collaboration among automakers, policymakers, and innovators on an international scale. I wonder how plausible that is. Thanks for riding along with me today. I'd love to hear your thoughts in the comments. Do you think wireless EV charging will become the norm, or are the challenges too steep? Thanks so much to the sponsor of today's video, Test Equity, and thanks as always to the invaluable support from the Engineering with Rosie Patreon team. If you'd like to join us, you can sign up at this link.